I think we should have another round of applause for the fact that this is the winner of the César for Best Director for 2015 for this film. Well deserved. Come on. We had to do it, right? Yeah, okay. You know, I think that after I saw the film, I couldn't get over the fact that we're so used to seeing movies about young lovers and adolescent love, and they're all made from the perspective of, oh, we were so crazy back then, look at how unreasonable we were, and how crazy it was, and how far we went, and how extreme we were, and we look back on it now, and we're so much wiser. And this film is exactly the opposite. It puts you right in the middle of what it is to be, it not only puts you right in the middle of it, to be in love and young and desperately in love, but then to look back on it and be still there with it and regretting that maybe you didn't do the loved one right. That's something that seems absolutely singular to me. I just want to start the conversation.
My way to answer to that would be, you know, I think that they were absolutely reasonable. You know, when you are 17, you are absolutely reasonable. You know, you are not reasonable later in your life, you know, but they were perfectly right, you know.
Like us
he
now.
Was right. Like Esther. Esther is right about everything. Mm-hmm. And it's funny because, you know, thinking about the characters, you know, about the three actors playing the part of Paul Dédalus in the film, I was thinking, looking at the performances, you know, during the editing, that Paul Dédalus has this problem with his mother, you know, his terrible relationship with his mother, etc. And after that, you can see him, you know, played, you know, by Quentin Dolmaire as a young boy, as a young man. And he's behaving as if he was 55 or 65, like an old, very, he's cautious, he's so reasonable, he's so precise, he's so shy, he's so shallow in a way, and he needs Esther to become a man. And when I see Matthew's performance in the film, it's as if he was waiting for his late 40s to become an adolescent at last, you know? And so I love the fact that the portrait of this young man was the portrait of this young man as a very reasonable guy, you know, very adult and mature, and that when he's coming, you know, when he's getting older, now he allows himself to be the adolescent that he did not allow himself to be, you know, when he was at this age, you know.
Yes.
And then he can think, you know, what a fool was I, you know, because I, you know, so that would be my way to react.
We were talking before when we did this conversation earlier about the question of autobiography. You were asked the question of autobiography, and you had a very specific answer for that, because the film, and all of your films really, feel they have the texture of autobiography and the feeling of autobiography, even when they aren't necessarily autobiographical. And you were speaking of this in relationship to Philip Roth, so I thought that might be an interesting
question. Yeah, it's something, you know, when I'm... I love the fact that, you know, that you can feel uncomfortable looking at my films, you know, thinking, is it that autobiographical? It's embarrassing, you know, it's too much, you know, it's not proper, you know, it's, you know, I like that kind of feeling, you know, and in a way, it's something that I'm asking to the actors. What I mean by that is that, you know, when I'm hiring actors, it's because I think that their talent is great, I think that their craft is wonderful, etc., etc. But when we are on the set, and if they just give me their craft or their talent, my answer is it's not enough. I need from you, you know, something more personal, more intimate, more embarrassing. I need to you to show something hidden. You know, I need to give you some personal material, you know. And so trying to be an actor amongst my troupe, you know, I'm trying to give you, you know, in the writing process and in the directing process, I'm trying to give you something personal, even if my own life is not as interesting as, you know, Paul Dédalus' life. You know, I didn't experience all these amazing things which are, you know, happening to him. So, and yes, and when we are discussing that, you know, I say that it's a shock that I had with the Truffaut's film, you know, who is giving this feeling of intimacy, you know, the deep intimacy, you know, something which is so personal that it's almost embarrassing. And I was mentioning a writer who has been so important for me and who is still so important for me, who's Philip Roth, you know. And you think when you are reading his books, I mean, it's too close to you, I mean, it's too dangerous, you know. And this feeling is great for me, it's a thriller, you know.
So to do that with adults and to work that way with adults in your films is one thing, but this is the first film in quite a long time where you've worked with so many young people. It was a very new experience for you. So to get young people to that place where they're feeling like they're revealing something intimate and surprising you, that's a different story than working with older people, huh?
Not about the intimacy. You know, I was afraid, you know, it was the first time that where I was writing, you know, for young actors, you know, doing the writing, and I was really afraid, you know, because, you know, I, at my age, I know that I'm, you know, sometimes I think, okay, I'm okay as a writer, you know, I can write good lines, tricky ones, you know.
Yeah. No, you're
and
not
that
bad.
Experience,
yeah,
I'm not, yeah. I'm okay,
yeah.
Okay. And so I know that some experienced actors will have some pleasure to play my lines, you
right.
know. But what I didn't know is that, you know, will my lines be able, will be there useful to young actors, you know, will they be able to express themselves and to stand for their own generation through my lines, you know? Yeah. And I thought, I won't be a good writer if my writer I just, you know, written, you know, for experienced actors, you know?
Yeah.
So I wanted to confront my material, you know, to young actors. And, you know, and it was their first film, the first film for Lou, the first film, you know, for Quentin.
Yes.
And I was afraid, you know, because I thought my lines are tricky, you know, so we'll have the craft to go through them. You
right.
know, I'm thinking about the scene in the museum, you know, when he's depicting the face of Esther saying your face is a landscape, you know, and et cetera, et cetera. It's tricky to go through these lines, you know. But they had this talent, you know.
Mm-hmm.
And also, you know, and it's difficult, you know, for me to speak with a younger generation. You know, it was a crave that I had, you know, to be able to speak to a younger generation. You know, but would I be able to establish the friendship that you need in the the making of a film?
Yes.
You know, with a new generation, and it worked.
Yeah.
It worked
mm-hmm.
incredibly. You know, the actress who is playing the sister, you know, her name is Lily Tayeb.
Who is 14 years old?
She's sorry.
14 years
14,
old.
You know, when we did that scene, you know, coming from Chekhov, you know, where she's saying I'm ugly, you know,
mm-hmm.
and you know, father, why did you make me ugly, etc.,
mm-hmm.
etc. And our collaboration had been so deep, you know. I mean, mm-hmm. it was really fulfillment. Yeah.
Mm-hmm. Does anyone have any questions that they'd like to? Yes. Sorry. No, there's someone right here. Yes. Yeah. It's a question about the Russian sequence in the film, and why did Arnaud have this material in the film?
I mean, it's a period film. So the film, the main one, the one about Esther, is happening during the fall of the wall, and you know, and so I had three separated stories. You know, the childhood, the Russia, and then Esther. And I thought, you know, to go through all these different stories, which each one of them belonging to a different genre, I liked to find a thread, you know, going through going through all these three stories, you know, and this thread became to be a sort of what I was calling on the set the Russian song, you know. He's very young. He's leaving his mother's house, going to his grand-aunt house, you know, and then he meets the beloved of his grand-aunt, and this woman is Russian and teach him some Russian bits and pieces, a few words. And after that, he has to do this trip with his friend and for the refusnik. And after that, he was so sure he would go, he can see the fall of the wall and everyone is rejoicing, you know, and he thinks there's something sad. I'm losing my childhood, you know, seeing the fall of the wall. And after that, he was so sure he would go to Africa, but his teacher died and he finished in Tajikistan, which is a former Soviet Republic. And so there is a sort of fate upon Paul Dédalus, which always brings him back to Russia, you know, the other side of Europe, you know, the other, like a mystery to him, you know. So I don't know why I use this mystery, you know, but I knew that, you know, on a musical level, it made sense to me to have this Russian song going through the whole film, you know, and driving my character, you know, from Roubaix to Tajikistan, you know, and with all these recurrent motifs about the Russia, you know, which is the other part of the world, you know, because he grew up in a world which was separated in two pieces, And then he realized that he's in one world, you know. Mm-hmm. And the film was also dealing with this this period and this issue. Mm.
Yes, and that. A question from Annette Ensdorf about François Truffaut, who she knew very well, and about specifically the relation of Truffaut's films and the letter writing in many of his films, actually, and which is something that's in other films of yours other than this one, but specifically Annette is referring to a film called Two English Girls, Les Deux Anglaises et le Continent, and how that relates to Arnaud's films, in addition to the intimacy that he discussed before.
It also has to do, obviously, I can't say that I started to want to make films, you know, when I saw Truffaut's movie, you know, because, you know, in my early years, you know, I was, you know, pro Godard, which meant, you know, in these days, you know, against Truffaut. You know, so as everyone in France, you know, I loved Godard and I hated Truffaut's God, you know. And after that, you know, I had really a revelation, you know, when I saw, you know, the 400 Blows, you know, at the age of 25, 6, I was that old, you know. And then I saw it, you know, and already started to work in the cinema. And so suddenly I saw that he found solutions to problems, you know, to so many problems. And so he started, and that's where it's when I met Truffaut, you know, very late in my life at 26, then I said, okay, perhaps I could become a director. So, you know, my gratitude with Truffaut is huge and so vast. And is, you know, I can't, you know, each morning I'm thinking about Truffaut and each evening I'm thinking about Truffaut. But, you know, I should mention another deep influence on this film because it's an epistolary novel in a way. You know, so the Two English Girls for sure, but I should mention The Age of Innocence and the use of the voiceover by Scorsese in The Age of Innocence, you know. And after that, let's say that I'm afraid I will regret that line, you know, but I'm playful. So, you know, the idea of, you know, having a narrator, you know, and, you know, and the common knowledge is saying, you know, that narrators are forbidden in the cinema school, you know, that you don't have to use narration, you know, in a film, etc. I thought it would be nice to allow myself to use a narrator, but who would start, you know, right in the middle of the film, when he's looking at Esther dancing. So you have whole half of the movie, you know, without a voiceover, and suddenly a narrator, and I'm playing the part, is saying, by the way, here I am, you know. And I thought it was, yeah, playful, you know, with you.
Yeah, it's also an Age of Innocence. You have the reading of letters and a direct address to the camera, right? Yeah. Mm-hmm. Yeah. Yes. One sec.
Parts of the score were very reminiscent of Bernard Herrmann's score for Vertigo. I'm wondering if that was deliberate or what
the purpose was. It's a question about Grégoire Etel's beautiful score and whether the echoes of Vertigo, the score for Bernard Herrmann's score for Vertigo, were deliberate.
there are quotes of Vertigo and on another film by Truffaut with Bernard Herrmann, which is the Fahrenheit 451, you know, which is a film that I love, and it's a complaint that I have from the composer. You know, we did, you know, a few films together, and on each new film he's saying, you know, he's asking to me, you know, will you go on, you know, harassing me with Bernard Herrmann. And and I think that ultimately, I won't stop. You know, I think that ultimately Bernard Herrmann is the definition of a proper score on a film. You know, for me, I have the use of that. And is it a quote? I guess it's a quote too, you know, because when Esther appears, that's where you have during the party they have at home, you know, you have a slow motion picture on her, you know, crossing the corridor, and then suddenly the camera starts to be at the right speed. And you have this motive, you know, coming from Vertigo, and is Avis, as if she was appearing as a ghost or a spirit or something like that. And so, yeah, I guess it has to do with vertigo and its motifs that I'm going through again and again and again. And so I accept the critic, you know, and as my composer is saying, when you will stop to harass me, you know. Until now, I didn't find another answer.
Is the film, has the film been released in the Middle East, and are there places where, has it been released in places where there are underground cinemas?
Actually, the film in the Middle East, if you are thinking about Iran or other countries like that, you know, because they have some nudities, you know, in the film, it's not possible to show the film in these countries, you know. But I was quite proud because I had an interview something like 3 weeks ago with a Tajikistan journalist. And she said, but by the way, you have been in Tajikistan for real. You know, I saw the film, you know, and we showed it, you know, in a film festival in Tajikistan, you know, which is a very, prudish, you know, country. But they showed it, you know, because they were proud of that. And she started to ask me questions about the Tajik cinema, and I was barely able to answer. And I was so flattered, you know, that the film was shown there. So I know that the film has been shown in Tajikistan, but in Iran, no, it's not possible.
Mm-hmm. Yes. I'll just repeat the question briefly in case anyone didn't get it. It's about the fact that Arnaud is repeating the characters of Paul and Esther from the film that he made 20 years ago, My Sex Life, as it's known here, Comment Je Me Suis Disputé, and looking at the relationship through a different lens, let's say, and is it part of, is he planning to do a trilogy?
Yeah, you know, to make a film is so exhausting, you know, that when, you know, when I finished that one, you know, I said, you know, I want to get rid of Paul Dédalus, I'm done, you know, I said everything that I had to say about Paul Dédalus, you know, and after that we had a screening, you know, with for the crew and the technicians and the actors, etc., and Mathieu was there, and was he pretty drunk? Yes, he was, you know, and he asked me, you know, Arnaud, actually, you know, what I wish, you know, is that if you could have a long life, you know, if you arrive into your 70s or 80s, you know, perhaps you could think about a sort of a remake of Sarabande, you know, the last film by Bergman, you know, where you could find the couple who was in a scene of a marriage, you know, again, you know, Erland Josephson and Liv Ullmann. And so, and we would see, you know, because, you know, all the film was built on the lack of Esther as an adult. So I knew in the writing of it, you know, that I would miss Emmanuel DeVos during the whole film, as the character Mathieu is missing Esther during the whole film. So I had to build this film around the lack, you know.
And we need to specify that Emmanuel DeVos, for those who haven't seen it, played Esther in My Sex Life.
In My Sex Life, yeah. And he said, you know, and so in that film that you would make, you know, but when we will be in our 70s or 80s, you know, we will be old and so mean, you know, and we will hate each other, you know, and we will meet again, and it will be a strange battle between these two old guys, you know, and it will be good, you know, but just when we'll be 80, you know, not before that.
Did you have it? It's a comment on the music that this woman the score also evoked the scores for Truffaut's films.
Yeah, actually the opening motif, it's on the credits. I didn't steal it. I paid for it. Yeah. 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 On the opening scene, the score is coming from shoot the piano player. It's a bit which is opening and closing the film. It's coming from the shoot the piano player. Yeah, it is. So it's just quotes, you know. That's why, you know, my composer is complaining. You know, it's because I love him, you know, but I prefer Truffaut and Herman.
Music by other people.
Thank you.
This is a comment about the first exchange between Paul and Esther in the schoolyard, and the fact that throughout the scene, the way that it's shot, the line, the eye lines are crossed continually. It's Arnaud's breaking the rule of filmmaking, and did he do that intentionally? Did he plan it, or did he find it in the editing room?
You know, on the set, you know, I'm trying, you know, as I said, you know, I like to be one actor amongst the actors, you know, so I try to know my lines, what I, before the shooting, before the day of shooting, you know, so what I mean by learning my lines is that I have tons of notes of how I will shoot it, you know, but I'm trying just, you know, as an actor to be able to improvise a bit, you know, and to add something to what I planned. So I remember the way it was shot. It was quite planned, but I tried, you know, I had this idea to go, you know, to the regular shot and reverse, and to go to what you call the French way and what we call the English way, yeah. You know, when you are up on the back. And so I'm afraid it was a little bit planned. you know, because it was tricky to make it work, you know, and so, but it was a long scene. We had a lot of material, you know, to have that, and in and I love the first appearance of Esther, you know, sitting on this sort of solid rock, you know, yeah. And she's like a statue, and she's not vulnerable. Nothing can hurt her. You know, she's the woman with the three husbands, you know, she has three boyfriends. She's the queen, you know, and she's not vulnerable. And I love the movement, you know, going from that scene where she's so, as if the camera is turning around them, as if she was turning around him, and saying, okay, you will never forget me, you know, because I'm I'm unforgettable. And so, you know, and I love the fact that the camera was turning around as a sort of point of view of Paul, who is mesmerized by this girl. And I love the movement, you know, it's something which moves me deeply, and I think I owe it to the performance of Lou, you know, who becomes so vulnerable at the end of the movie, you know. She was like a statue, and she's becoming human at the she's becoming a woman at the end of the film, and so she should be proud of it, you know, because she's becoming the hero she wanted to be, but now everything hurts her, but it's too late to go back to this invulnerability that she had at the beginning of the movie in this opening scene.
The piece by Stravinsky, yeah, that you include in the film, yeah, is
it's a quote of Herman.
It's his last piece, correct? It's Hugo Wolf, and he's reorchestrating this piece. But is this also in some way a continuation of what you call the Russian song?
It is, in a way. Yeah. It has to do with the Russian song. It's a piece that I love. It's the last piece of Stravinsky, and it's influenced by Hugo Wolf, you know, and Hugo Wolf was not that famous in France nor in America. And so there was a revival of Hugo Wolf, and you had this German singer whose song is sung, I forget, and she toured in US. And I read, you know, on internet, you know, that she had this big concert in Los Angeles. And I love, and it was, you know, and so this piece is from 68, the Stravinsky piece, and Vertigo is from 58. Yeah. And the concert which happened with the Hugo Wolf songs, you know, happened in the late 40s, yes, you know. And I love to think in the audience there was Herman and Stravinsky in Los Angeles, the both of them listening to Hugo Wolf, you know, and one of them composed, you know, the score of Vertigo, and the other one composed the song of Hugo Wolf, you know. And I love to think that noble arts are paying a tribute in that music, you know, to the humble arts like Bernard Herrmann. You know, I love to think that this is a tribute to Stravinsky, to Bernard Herrmann.
Yes. In this film and in the previous film, do you mean
my sex life?
Yeah, okay. So in both films, in My Golden Days and in My Sex Life, there's the issue of friendship and of confronting a friend, and the issue of betrayal. And does this reflect Arnaud's ideas about friendship?
I can see there is a line. You know, there are conflicts. I guess there are rivalries between the two male characters. You know, and you know, at the end of the movie, you know, when Mathieu is yelling at Kowalki, you know, and when he's so aggressive, and gross, and I love that. And so there is a rivalry with this one, but there is love too. You know, when he's going, you know, to Russia with Mark Zuckerberg, you know, he's in the synagogue, and the guy is asking to him, but you're not a Jew, you know, so why do you bother? Why do you go and make this trip? And see, he's looking at his friend and saying, because Mark is my friend. And it's a perfect answer. It's an absolute love. And after that, you know, he's saying to Esther, you know, and after that, Mark left for Lyon, and I never saw him again. So there are two kinds of, you know, and I remember in my sex life, you have two friends, you know, one being Nathan, and he's in love with Nathan. And the other one being the rival, and the other one being Rabier. So I guess it's two ways of, you know, being madly in love with another man, or being in rivalry with, you know, with the darker figure.
But he had been close friends with Rabier previously.
He used to be. Yes. He used to be a close friend, yeah.
Right.
Yeah.
Yeah.
I remember, you know, it's stupid, but it's late, and I remember because, you know, I was so proud, you know, because, you know, when we showed the film, you know, at the New York Film Festival, you know, for the American audience, you know, I could hear good laugh in the audience during that scene where Mathieu is so insulting. And after that, you know, during the same trip, you know, I left New York to go to Tokyo where we showed the film. And in Tokyo, the audience was so still, you know. And after that, I spoke with the journalist and the audience, and they say, don't you think that scene is a little bit insulting? And my answer was, it's totally insulting, you know. So.
Can you repeat the question just a little bit louder? Has age changed the way that... Oh, has age changed the way that Arnaud approaches the telling of a coming-of-age story?
I'm not sure. Actually, I'm not sure. I know one thing is that when I was younger, I was, and even before beginning that film, my anxiety about directing inexperienced actors was terrible. Really, I mean, I was terrified, really terrified. You know, because when I start a film, you know, I think, you know, will I be able to help the actors to give a good performance, you know? And I know, I knew, you know, when I started to make the film, like La Vie des Morts, or that, I knew that I was not that bad, at, you know, for that job with experienced actors, you know? But with inexperienced actors, I was terrified. I thought, you know, I will never be able to do it. But perhaps becoming older, you know, I was able to manage my fear and to start a dialogue with them. You know, and it's funny, you know, it has to do with real life too. You know, what I mean is that in real life, I have to perform, but in real life, let's say that I'm shy. You know, so I have nephews and nieces, you know, and I'm a terrible uncle, you know. What I mean by that, you know, is, you know, sometimes I start to speak and I think, you know, Arnaud, you're so talkative, please shut up. I mean, you are an embarrassment for the nephew and nieces, you know. And after that, I stay quiet and think, come on, you look dead. I mean, you are so boring, you're such a bore. I mean, they will hate you, you know. I'm not a good uncle, I'm really not, you know. But on a set, I was able to build that friendship, you know, that I'm not able to build, you know, in my real life. And that was an accomplishment, you know, for me to have the trust of these young kids, you know, and they knew that they had my trust, you know, and so we were sharing an experience. And I'm sure that I would haven't been able to do that, you know, before, you know, my 50s.
So please join us in 30 years for the third part of the trilogy, made out of anger and bitterness, and thanks.